I'd like to invite you to listen to about 30 seconds of vocals here in Studio One, which includes some lead vocals at the beginning, some lead with a couple of harmonies, and then towards the end, some lead vocals with four harmonies. Just have a listen and see if anything occurs to you.
Was it the fear of my touch? Was I too near you too much, too soon? That kept you running. Oh, 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 oh. Just go.
Now, you may or may not have liked the vocals, the song, the performance, all kinds of things there, but hopefully at least the vocals did sound natural. But I have to tell you that all of these vocals, including all of the harmonies, were pitch corrected using Melodyne in Studio One. And I'm hoping that you didn't hear many of the things that you associate with pitch correction, that sort of robotic feel or a lack of emotion, a sterile feel. Hopefully it did sound natural to you. And I think that's because of a minimalistic approach I take to using Melodyne in Studio One. Let's talk about that. Hi folks, I'm Mike and I hope you're well. I want to start off with an apology. I'm in the process of moving my studio from one location to another at the moment. So I'm kind of stuck in the corner of this room and I'm afraid it's not properly treated for sound. So my voice may sound a little bit funky at times. And I know how important the human voice is to human ears. That brings us on to the subject of this video. Studio One Professional comes with a version of Melodyne called Melodyne Essentials. And I'm going to be covering that in this video and looking at the basic tools for correcting pitch on vocals. I think it's a really incredible tool. Let's start off with something that if you've already played around with this, you may have gotten wrong already. One of the rookie mistakes you can make with Melodyne in Studio One is just to insert it as a regular plugin. What do I mean by that? If you were to go to this vocal track here, for example, go up to inserts, click on plus, go down to Solemnity, and then click on Melodyne. You can actually insert it as a plugin like this and use it, yeah? Now, you may have got stuck at this stage. I'll just give you a hint. The next thing you would have to do is click on the transfer button here and then actually play your whole vocal track.
Was it the touch of my hand?
Now, I'm going to stop it there. I'm not going to subject you to the whole song. It would take a while to do that, and it takes Melodyne a while to actually process it so that you can start using it. That's if you use this method. This really exists for other doors which don't have the same capabilities as Studio One. So let's look at the way you should use it in Studio One. So Melodyne uses a technology called ARA or A-R-A to communicate audio file information directly to Melodyne for processing. So we're not going to need to insert it as we did before, but instead we're going to apply it to the actual track itself at the top here. Now, before we do that, a quick bit of housekeeping. You can see that my vocal here is divided into several different clips, and we can apply Melodyne to individual clips like this if we wish, but I find it much quicker just to apply it to the whole performance. So I'm just going to drag across and select all of those clips. And then here on PC, I'm going to press Control B to bounce all of those together. It would be Command B on a Mac. I'll do that, and you can see it's now just one clip. Now, to edit with Melodyne, all we have to do is press Control M. M is for Melodyne, or on Mac, Command M. Okay, but if you don't have that available, your keyboard shortcuts are messed up or whatever, you can just right click on the clip, go down to audio, and then just go to edit with Melodyne. Okay, now as soon as we do that, you can see that Melodyne appears in the edit view down at the bottom, and we didn't have to actually play the song for it to analyze it. It's already got all the information it needs using that technology ARA, and we can start using Melodyne right away. So it's much quicker, much more direct. Now, I just want to quickly point out a few of the basics with the Melodyne interface here. First of all, one thing it's done is it's picked up the key signature of this song. You can see it there, D major, okay. Now, the importance of that is that if we look at these notes here, we can see that the white and gray lines represent keys on like a piano keyboard, yeah? And some of them are grayed out, yeah? Those are the notes that don't belong to that key signature. It means that when we start moving notes around later, they're going to snap to notes which are in the key signature. Now, of course, with some pieces of music, there may be some variations where you've got notes which are not in the key signature. So you don't have to leave that snap turned on, but it's helpful most of the time. If you do want to switch it off, just go up to options up here, go to pitch grid, and you can see you can turn it off there to no snap, okay? Ordinarily, I leave it turned on. Now, I just want to talk about how to navigate the view here. Of course, you can use the scroll bars at the bottom, yeah, just to scroll through the performance like so. Or you can use the ones at the side, the one at the side, the right-hand side here. I prefer to use my scroll wheel on my mouse, so I can just use that to move up and down. If I hold shift on my keyboard, I can use it to move from side to side as well. And if I hold control, I can zoom in and out using the scroll wheel on my mouse. Another thing you can do to zoom in and out, if you look at the scroll bars, at, say the bottom here on Melodyne, and you can drag those, as I say, but you can also grab the ends of them. And then you can drag the ends in, and that has the effect of zooming in and out. And you can just about see there's a grayed out representation of the waveform there. So that can be kind of handy if you just want to really hone in on a specific part of the waveform there, yeah? That can be a nice, efficient way of doing it as well. So I'll leave that up to you. So that's the basics of the navigation. Let's start adjusting the pitch. So I've zoomed into the first couple of phrases of the performance here, and you can see that we've got these sort of yellow shapes with red outlines. These are called blobs, and they're the things that we can actually manipulate in terms of like dragging them around to change pitch, etc. Okay. But you can also see there's these lines that run through them. That's the actual pitch. And you can see it moves up and down quite a bit. And that's the human voice. It's not a sine wave. It doesn't just stay on a constant pitch. It is sort of human. It's not perfect. And that's what we love about it. Okay, so that's the main things that we can see here. Now, I just want to mention that before I do any pitch correction, I like to set up the door in a specific way. I like to solo the vocal, yeah, which I've done now. And then I like to have one other instrument, a reference instrument. I'm going to use the guitar in this case. I find if I have the whole mix, sometimes it's difficult to discern what I'm hearing. And if I listen to it in isolation, just the soloed vocal, then I end up making some strange decisions because I haven't got the rest of the track to sort of compare it to. So that's the way I like to work with this. Now, one thing I could do down here in the bottom view is press Control A or Command A to select everything, yeah? And then I could just like double click on one of these blobs here and you'll see everything move. Bang. I have now pitch corrected everything in the performance. Now, this probably doesn't sound too bad. Let's have a quick listen.
Was it the touch of my hand?
It's okay for this particular performance, but I find if I use this methodology, I've got more chance of it sounding a little sterile and just not very human, okay? I think it's the imperfections which actually sort of help it to remain human. So I'm going to undo that. I prefer to use my ears. I know it's remarkable, isn't it? So I'm going to be listening out for things which actually sound a little off, okay? Now, I can visually try and identify them. I'll talk about that in a moment. But in particular, I like to listen out for long notes to begin with, okay? Because long notes give us a chance to hear it as a listener and go, that's a bit off. So for example, here's a big long note at the end here. Now, it looks like it's sitting perfectly on the F sharp there, okay? And it kind of is close to that. But if we really want to correct that, we can just double click on it like so. And you saw it just shifted a little bit, okay? It just went a little bit sharper. And I generally find that's helpful with long notes in terms of getting the pitch correct. There's one just before that, yeah? I could do the same with that. Let's just have a quick listen.
Was it the touch of my hand?
It's really important to listen after you've made these changes, I find, because it doesn't always sound correct, even though it looks correct. Now, you can see here that there's one note right at the beginning, a low note here, where it's really halfway between these two notes. And this is a visual cue for me, where it's a little bit further off from the ones that we looked at just a moment ago. And that could really stand out. And I think it does a little bit.
Was it the touch of my hand?
depends on how sensitive you are to pitch as to whether you pick that up, but I can hear that a little. So I'm just going to double click on that one. And you can see it's gone up to the A note there. Okay, let's have a listen.
Was it the touch of my hand?
And that's it. To be honest with you, that's my whole method. I just double click on blobs where I feel like, yeah, it's just a little bit off. And I generally leave the rest alone until something, you know, really strikes me as being off. Now, I just want to mention that sometimes it's so far off that it ends up landing on the wrong note. You can actually drag these notes to completely different pitches, which I've done there. I've actually changed the melody now by dragging this so far. Have a quick listen.
Was it the touch of my hand?
Okay, now this is where I find things start to sound pretty unnatural. Yeah, the pitch was interesting there, but yeah, I don't know. It didn't sound very natural to me anymore. I'll undo that. But I'll tell you where that does work sometimes. Sometimes when you're working with harmony vocals, yeah, where they're just supporting the main vocal, and if you just want to try out a different harmony to the one that was originally sung, or if the singer just really got the pitch right off, you know, then I think that's worth experimenting with sometimes. Now, as I say, that's my basic method, but there's a couple of other things I think you should know. So I mentioned earlier that this line which runs through our blobs is the pitch curve. It represents actually what's happening with the pitch. And you can see there's some natural drift with that in the human voice. Now, we can tame that if we wish with something called the pitch drift tool. Now, I'm using the studio version of Melodyne here. So I think the menu may be slightly different in terms of how you get to this in the essential version, which you get with Studio One Professional. So I'll just show you a couple of different ways I know of that you can get to it. First of all, let's select this blob here. There is a menu item at the top here, yeah, which is the pitch correction macro. If we click on that, this interface opens and we can just drag this slider here, yeah, to just adjust the drift. And you can see it's just taming that pitch drift there. So I find that that's often quite useful when things get out of hand, okay? Another way that I know to get to this would be to right click, yeah, go to this second option here, and down at the bottom, we can see there's a pitch drift tool here, okay? And then we can drag that to get a more accentuated result. Let me know in the comments down below if that is in Essential, because I'm not absolutely sure. But that's just another way that you can tame the pitch. Let's look at yet another tool that I use routinely. This example is a good example of our decision-making process. Should we even fix this is the question. Well, let's discuss that first, and then I'll talk about how we would fix it. I want you to pay attention to this last note here, this long note, okay? Have a listen to it with the guitar. Now, as that note fades out, it disappears in the mix a little bit, doesn't it? If we actually listen to it in solo, I think you'll hear, and you can kind of see this here, it goes just a little bit flat on the tail end of the note here. Let's have a listen. Yeah, just that part there. Have a listen again one more time. Now, you may or may not decide to fix that, okay, because it is a little bit sort of buried in the mix. Now, if you did decide you want to fix it, you first of all would have a problem, wouldn't you? Because what can you do with this note? You can center it. We'll click on that, yeah, but it's still going to go flat on the end. Yeah, and we're moving it as a whole. So we actually need to split it so we can treat this last part of it separately. So if we go to the blob and just move our cursor just a little bit above it, you can see our cursor changes to this new icon here. Now just double click wherever that is, and you can see that we now have two blobs. It's split it, okay? This one is centered on the pitch. This one's a little bit below. It's a little bit flat. Let's click on that. And now let's have a listen. And it holds the pitch so much better there. Let's have a listen in context with the guitar. Now, of course, at the moment, you may have decided, I don't need to fix that, it's buried in the mix. But what about after you do things like sort of use compression or automation, and that tail actually becomes a little bit louder? It may stand out more there. So that's how you go about splitting notes and then treating them separately. Now, I definitely think that before you start using Melodyne on your vocals, you should do your vocal comping. Comping is the process where we take several takes of a performance and we stitch them together, hopefully seamlessly, to get the best of all of the performances all together. You should definitely check it out, and I've made a video about it right here. Watch this before you start using Melodyne.